Penguin Random House Audio presents Live, Learn, Love Well, Lessons from a Life of Progress, Not Perfection. This is the author, Emma Lovewell. To my father, Mark Allen Lovewell, and my mother, Teresa Yuan, thank you for encouraging me to use my creativity always. I love you. Introduction. On August 2, 2022, I celebrated my 5th anniversary at Peloton. Though we announced my anniversary ride a week before, we had actually been planning it for months. In one of our scheduling meetings earlier that year, my producer had said, "Your 5-year anniversary is coming up. Do you want to teach a special ride to celebrate?" 5 years. It seemed like both a minute and a lifetime. I thought of how far I'd come in that time, and what everyone had been through in the last few years, all of the hardships and successes I'd heard about from Peloton members, and I thought, yes. Never miss a moment to celebrate how far we've come. As soon as my producer and I started discussing ideas for the ride, I knew I wanted to use the same playlist I'd used during my premiere ride for Peloton, a list I had agonized over 5 years earlier. Why? Because those songs still have the power to move me. They had been so special to me that I'd picked them for one of the most pivotal days of my life. As the first strains of Creep by TLC came on last August, I felt transported back, not only to 1994 when the song came out, but also to that first day in 2017 when my body was vibrating on the platform with nerves, excitement, and anticipation of what was to come. I don't remember much about what I said on my first ride, but I remember exactly how I felt. I couldn't believe I was here, in New York, teaching a class I loved to 2,300 people, when the record for live members was 1,000. I had been teaching fitness for a few years, but only to 50 people in a room at once. Peloton was already a thriving company when I joined in 2017. It had been founded in 2012, and I was instructor number 11 at the time. But I was new and I wanted so much from that premiere ride. It was my introduction to this incredibly passionate and engaged group of people, members, and employees, and I wanted to show my authentic self. I wanted all of us to finish the ride feeling connected and exhilarated. I hoped that I would be well received. I wanted everyone at home to experience the same brilliant spark of energy and fun that is the power source for my life. To feel free, capable, and resilient, the way I do when I finish a workout. Could I give that feeling to every rider with me that day? Some of the other instructors were riding in the front row to support me. I remember looking out just beyond my handlebars and seeing Robin, Allie, Cody, Hannah, Jess King, and Christine all beaming while looking back up at me. I was so nervous I could have blacked out, but I knew I was ready for this moment. TLC led into the opening notes of my favorite Janet Jackson song, and they put me right in the groove. A hair flip, then a body roll, and my whole being was moving along to the music. My pedal strokes were right on the beat with the bass, and I started to fly. I was concentrating so hard on creating a positive experience for everyone that I didn't read even one leaderboard name. To any of you who hit a milestone that day of my first ride, please know I was so proud of you. Even if I hadn't quite mastered how to say it yet. It felt like I was doing a million things at once. I was glancing at my notes to stay on track, tossing out a few words of encouragement, and trying to remember to move my gaze between the camera and the members in the studio. When the premiere ride was finished, I took a deep breath and wiped the sweat off my face, still buzzing from the thrill of it all. I almost couldn't believe I had had the opportunity to share my passion for fitness with all those people at once. The number of live riders has gotten much higher in recent years, but at the time, 2,300 riders felt like a million. That initial ride was hard, and I finished it both satisfied with how it had gone and eager to tackle everything I still had to learn. But the very first time I said, "What's up, Peloton? I'm Emma Lovewell," I felt like I was opening an exciting new chapter in the story of my life. And I couldn't wait to see the rest unfold. I became a fitness instructor because I believe movement can change your mood and transform your mindset. My love of movement has been like a thread of positivity running through my life, even at my lowest moments. Movement isn't just a must-do for your body, it's like taking a multivitamin for your soul. Don't we all feel like happier and, let's be honest, nicer people after a workout? Movement is fun, especially when you find the kind that's right for you. It's also helped me stay connected to my body, shown me I can do hard things, and encouraged me not to give up when life gets tough. My story began when two unlikely people met by happenstance on a subway platform in New York City. My music-loving dad, Mark, was waiting for the 6 train after a gig when he encountered my beautiful mother, Teresa, who needed directions. Mom and her family had recently moved to New York from Taiwan to follow the path that they laid out for her. Study accounting, get a practical job, earn money, marry a Chinese man, and have a family. Falling in love with my folk-singing, white, Massachusetts-born father wasn't part of that plan. They had to hide their relationship at first. My mother would lie and say she was going to the library when she was really going to see my father. My mom and dad soon moved in together and started building a creative life for themselves. My dad was a musician and writer, and he encouraged and influenced my mother to follow her passion, so she transferred schools and enrolled at Pratt Institute School of Art in Brooklyn to study oil painting. New York City in the 1970s was a fascinating place of contradictions. It was glamorous and gritty, a haven for artists and musicians, a singular time that every dreamer like me probably now romanticizes. I picture them walking arm in arm, dad with his wavy brown hair and big beard, mom with her straight black hair that reached the middle of her back, their own version of John and Yoko, always headed to a Zen meditation workshop or an art gallery or to hear live music. My parents made the most of their time in New York City. My dad would perform at different cafes and bars downtown. To supplement his income, he worked at the South Street Seaport Museum as an editorial assistant, and then later at the New York Post as a copy boy. He remembers working during the bicentennial celebration at the seaport in 1976 with a parade of sailboats passing by. At the Post, he sometimes drove Rupert Murdoch home from the office in the afternoons. My mother, also young and very driven, worked at Time Life in the picture collections department. She would take hundreds of photo negatives and sort them into giant filing cabinets. My parents both worked full-time while attending college full-time. Hustling to make it is in my blood. As aspirational as it sounds to me now, I know it was hard for them too. And after several years in the big city, they decided to move to Martha's Vineyard. My father's family had been there for generations, and it made sense to raise a family there. Martha's Vineyard can be opulent, but our existence was hand-to-mouth. We were year-rounders, not the wealthy visitors who filled the boutiques and restaurants every summer. Dad was a reporter for the local paper, and Mom took care of my older brother, Alan, and eventually me. She also worked part-time in restaurants, cleaned houses, worked as a substitute teacher, and taught the occasional Chinese cooking class in the kitchen of our small house to make ends meet. Money was always tight, and we had to be very self-sufficient. Our family bought clothes and other things we needed at thrift stores. We had a moderate-sized garden where my mother grew vegetables and flowers. Always scrappy, I was taught by my parents that it's important to know how to fix things yourself. Even better, have the skills to build what you need. Our modest house with its vegetable patch was the opposite of the grand houses on the vineyard, with their meticulously kept lawns and clear blue swimming pools. I didn't always know it, especially when other kids had the coolest new toys and jeans that weren't a couple of inches too short, but I had everything I needed. I know the way I talk about the vineyard makes it seem like a little slice of heaven, and in some ways, it is. But so many parts of my life growing up there were challenging, especially in my teenage years when my family came apart, unexpectedly, at least to me, and I faced obstacles and setbacks to my dreams. But I look back on those years and realize that so much of the adversity I faced was forming the core of who I am and giving me the strength to pursue the passions I would eventually discover. I was being handed crucial tools to build a life for myself. Fast forward to that Peloton anniversary ride. When you get a moment like that to reflect, you can't help but think about all the twists and turns a life can take. The strange course that brought me from dancing my little heart out on the vineyard to audition after audition in New York City to years of wandering and wondering where next to take my passions to finally clipping into the bike in front of the whole world. Not to mention all the head-spinning things that have happened in the 5 years since I joined Peloton. We've been through so much on this bike together. Awakening.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.